All right, good to be back for Wednesday night. I want to thank the Lord for this privilege and thank Him for the rain we got. Everybody, I know people say, well, we've had too much. Well, you're not God, and I'm glad you ain't. But the Lord is blessed, and we just thank the Lord for all He's done. Leon's sick tonight, like you remember him, and pray for him and Liz, pray for Joanne, and keep praying that she'd keep getting better. When she gets feeling a little better, she tries to do too much, and it puts her right back where she was. So do pray. Pray for these that's lost a loved one. Pray for the family that lost all of these children in this shooting. And let's pray the Lord will touch there and help them. There ain't no words that can fill the emptiness in their hearts. We just have to pray that God would just surround them with His love and His glory. And let's pray for others that's lost their loved ones. Let's pray for this war that's going on. It's probably, our minds would be baffled by how many people over there that has just been killed for no reason. Unarmed people, killed children and all of that. Just because they're not going in there to fight a war. They're going in there to commit genocide. They want to do away with these people. I have a problem with that, and I pray God bring His wrath upon these people that's doing this. And so you pray that the Lord will touch there and others that are sick and afflicted. And Charles, and be praying for him. And pray the Lord will continue to bless and help in all things. There's others that are sick. I know there's other requests. Then there's people out there tonight. They might be sick. We don't know about it. And so I do remember them. Pray that the Lord will touch. For lost, let's pray God will touch there. Amen. Amen. Is there any spoken request?
Just my mom had the flu, tested positive for the flu today.
That's right. We were just talking about the flu. Amen. And let's pray for all these that stretch the truth about all this monkeypox. Amen. There wasn't a single mule had it. Amen. All right. May the Lord bless. There's a couple of donkeys that started it. And I'm being very polite. Amen. All right, unspoken, raise your hand. All right. Good to see little David back with us tonight. Amen. David, ask God's blessing, would you please?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity to be together tonight. Lord, have your way with the Holy Spirit, Jesus. There's so many of them out there that need to hear this message.
God bless.
Jesus, help them and be with them and deal with them. In Jesus' name we pray, and amen.
Amen. We want to pray for all these in our unseen audience today also. Amen. Amen. Well, I just found this out that Wayne's wife had to carry him to the doctor and carried him back there and done the examination and all that. Doctor come back out and got his wife over to the side and said, I just don't like the way he looks. She said, well, I don't like the way he looks either, but he's good around the house. Yeah, so that's right. Uncloudy day. Oh, they tell us of a home far beyond the sky. Tell us of a home far away. Oh, they tell us of a home where no snow does arrive. Yeah. Little man not with us? Now, what about the little girl? She's not with us. Hadley's not. I thought I seen Hadley come in. I must have been you dragging your feet back there. All right. You playing Elias? I guess that's a yes. Well, last week he was a kindergartner. This week he's a first grader.
All right.
He graduated. Sanders family didn't want you. Amen. Praise the Lord. I tell you, I think I've told Sandra this, but boy, I tell you, I used to get Walt so stirred up. I'd get him stirred up and he'd go to stuttering. I'd call him Lester Walker. He said, but preacher, I can't believe you say that. Amen. I miss him. All right, Wayne. Was that what you want you to do? Get out of your way? I'll get out of your way. I don't know that stuff. It don't look good to rub off.
Over there. Look what you got, Dorley. You ain't got her life in that.
Oh, Sam?
Yeah.
She, but everybody else is just hiding nervous. Y'all go ahead and let it die.
I will get it out of your system. Thank you for your blessing. As a world looks upon me, let us struggle along. They see I am
thank you, Lord, for your blessing.
I'm glad we can thank you, don't you? Well, it's good to be here again tonight.
Thank God for this opportunity to be in this house. We ain't worthy of his blessings on us, but I am so thankful for him. I truly am.
Let's see here real quick. Y'all just gonna have to give me just a second. Everything got scattered around on me. Oh, listen to this song. This song here. If I can hold a pick.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. His cornerstone. Bye.
do we have help, do we have strength? Without him, we don't have anything. Despite what the world tells you, the government can't give you nothing to help that's going to save you. A man can't give you nothing that's going to save you. The courts ain't going to give you nothing to save you. A doctor ain't going to give you nothing to save you. It might prolong the inevitable a little bit if God will it, but in the end, it takes Jesus. And that's who it's going to always take. Maybe save.
Help, Lord, here I am.
Keep the deer from eating the beans. I wish they'd like something else. Amen. So I'm going out there about every hour or two when the dogs are barking, running deer off. There's about 10 last night. And they got gone before I could get my gun. They'd been like old string bean, run little rabbit, run, run. The under comes David with a big shotgun. But while I was out there running the deer, I was hollering for the dogs, and they was up our tree in the possum. So there we are. But I reckon the Lord make a way for all things.
It was such a lovely day. Sun was shining bright. Gentle wind was blowing my way. Not a storm cloud in sight.
Settling of the stress and everything else that the devil tries to bring against us to get us down. I'm glad that he didn't leave us, Nancy. When he saved us, he didn't just say, "Now you go on by yourself." He said, "I will with you." Amen. And I'm so thankful that he is. And sometimes whoever said life was easy lied. Whoever said being a Christian was easy lied. Lied to your face.
Amen.
But what it is, we have a hope that you don't have when you're not a Christian. We have a hope and we have a help. We have a peace. We have a strength. We have a shelter in the midst of this storm. Amen. We have an eye in the middle of the hurricane. We have peace in the middle of the storm. And that's in Jesus Christ. When we're running away and not depending upon Him, fire's going to get you. Storm's going to consume you. But your peace is when you're staying sheltered in the arms of our blessed Savior.
Jesus.
Amen. Amen. I love you. I just want to say that.
The Lord can't send you and be a shepherd.
Amen.
He can only lead you. Amen. In order to be a shepherd. Think about that.
One dark night, an angel, a fearful time had come. One little Hebrew boy who was his father's firstborn son. Where the angel did pass him low, it was hard.
Do this for Rosie, walking through the valleys, and things that she's gone through and we're going through, and maybe you are. And sometimes we don't understand. People that are sick think God is mad at them. But every time you're sick doesn't mean that God is cursing you. But that's hard for people to understand. And the devil gets into your mind and puts things in there. And this song, the songwriter wrote about a valley, and wrote about it trying to give them the understanding that this valley has a purpose and a reason, okay? Let's
see. As I look down the mountainside, I can see where this road goes. The shepherd is
smarter than y'all, just makes me mark it. You'd have marked it too if you didn't know what I was going to be preaching at before we got down here, wouldn't we? We never know what God's going to do. We just believe and trust that God's going to do something, don't we? We're going to read 6 verses of Scripture. And you'll find that these are very familiar Scripture. And matter of fact, this same chapter is repeated in the book of Isaiah. But we're going to read it here out of 2 Kings. The Bible said, "In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. And the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, came to him and said unto him, Thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Then he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. And it came to pass, before Isaiah had gone out into the middle court, that the word of the Lord came to him, saying, Turn again, and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, Thus saith the Lord, the God of David thy father, I have heard thy prayer, I have seen thy tears. Behold, I will heal thee. On the third day thou shalt go up into the house of the Lord, and I will add unto thy days 15 years. I will deliver thee in this city out of the hand of the king of Assyria. And I will defend this city for my own sake and for my servant David's sake." Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that you let us come tonight. We thank you for your blessings. Thank you for the old songs, Lord, that were sung tonight. What a great melody of praise. And God, what a message they have instilled in our heart as we've heard tonight. Lord, we're thankful for each one that's come. We pray for those that are not with us, the sick, the afflicted. We pray for those, Lord, today that is hindered. And God, a lot of times our hindrance is self-afflicted. And God, I believe today that, Lord, that the church is important. And I believe today that we have folks that have found satisfaction, God, in the past year or so as they've forsaken the church. They think they can get what they need at home, but God, it's not the same. I believe today you'll bless those that can't come, but I don't believe they'll be blessed if they can. I ask you, God, to move. And Father, I realize today that people today don't want to hear this kind of thing. But Lord, if the church wasn't meant to be used, then God, why haven't we got it to start with? Why is it here, Lord, if it's not meant to be filled and used tonight? God, there's sickness tonight. Children that's sick, grown-ups that are sick, people that are facing things. And Lord, you tell us to pray one for another, and God, to bear one another's burdens. And Lord, these people are depending on us to help them pray and pray themselves out of the things that have come back now. And God, I do. And I pray you put your arms around them. And then, God, again, I pray for the families of these children that were killed. And Lord, I pray that you just put your arms around them. God, there's going to be many questions. And God, I don't have the answers, but Lord, you do. And I ask you, Father, just to minister to them all. And God, save that one that's lost. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I want to talk to you for a few minutes on when there's no time to waste. The Lord began to speak about this. I thought I would be preaching on something else. But I believe that each and every one of us need to give heed to these words in our own personal life when there's no time to waste. A lot of time we don't come to that agreement in our life till we've reached the end of our way. We realize we have no time to waste, but as we look back over the years that we have lived, we've wasted much time, haven't we? Much time. We need to consider if and when the time comes, and probably, no doubt it will, that, and we find ourselves in this situation where there's no time to waste. We find a time of perils, and we find, a friend of mine, these things that life bring upon us, and we need to fall down at the feet of Jesus, and we need to plead for his grace and mercy. We need to find that God still listens. You know, the only reason God ain't heard your prayer today is probably because you didn't pray it.
And if you did pray it, you didn't pray with a clean heart because we hadn't confessed our sins unto the Lord. This is a very interesting how this come about in Hezekiah's life. And how he had a prayer that could be prayed, that was an honest prayer, that when the minute it hit the ears of God, God responded. And how long's it been since you prayed a prayer and immediately God responded? I wish I could say he did on all of mine, but he hadn't, because it was the way I prayed them. Friend of mine, we come to a time when our relationship with him needs to be where we can call upon his name, and immediately our prayer enters the throne room of glory and we begin to reap the Lord's attention. You know, I found myself in some times in the past weeks that I needed God's attention immediately. Did you? Immediately. I would open the Bible to all of the scriptures that God would send to my mind, the healing scriptures, and read on man and confess on man and ask the Lord, this is what you say. And follow the instructions of God. And God has answered prayer. But it wasn't always immediate. You know what I'm saying? Friend of mine, there were times that I had to get me out of the way in order to get the attention of God. And there'll come that time in all of our lives. And we need to have a relationship with God to where we know that we can get an immediate response. That we can reap God's attention. You know, none of these things today may even take hold of your heart or grasp you in any way right now, but it will when you come to that place in your life when you don't have any more time to waste. When God has shown you, friend of mine, we've come down to the end of our way. We got to do what we got to do and do it quickly. Amen. I believe the church is running its course. We're on our last mile home. I don't know what y'all think, but I think we're on our last mile home. And, you know, when the world shows God that they no longer care about him or his house or the word of God or the ministry of the Lord, that there's no reason for God to leave the church. Is there? There's no reason. But we're on our last mile home. Somebody said, well, when's the Lord coming? Well, I don't know. I wouldn't pay attention to anybody that said they did. We got all the signs that tells us it's near, don't we? Amen. That is near. I wonder, friend of mine, what my response would have been if I was facing God's word as he sent, friend of mine, these things by Isaiah to Hezekiah. What would I have done? What does so many of us do, you know? The doctor said, well, there ain't no hope. There's people today that they gave up on years and years ago that had cancer and said, you're never going to make it, but they're still alive. Why? Because they got God's attention. They come down to the point in their life and they realize they didn't have no time to waste. They had to get earnest with the Lord. I wonder what my response would have been in Hezekiah's place. I wonder what you might have done. You know, Isaiah wasn't coming on a friendly to see how you're doing type of visit. He was sent with a message from the Lord to give Hezekiah, and the Bible tells us he was sick unto death. And these were words that was going to cut down into his heart. And friend of mine, surely not what he'd hoped to hear from the prophet of the Lord. How would you like to have a preacher with the bedside manner as Isaiah? Isaiah, Hezekiah, the Lord has sent a word. Hezekiah might have picked up a little bit because he thought it was something good. And Isaiah said, set your house in order. God said, you're going to die. And you're not going to live. Not too many of us would want a pastor like that, would we? But these are his words, and they came from God. They were not what Isaiah wanted to tell him. He said, thus saith the Lord, to set thy house in order, thou shalt die and not live. Amen. Hezekiah did question God's word. Not one time did he question that what God said wasn't true.
He didn't ask Isaiah, are you certain that's what God told you? He didn't ask that. He realized that what God had said was true, and unless he could find grace in the eyes of the Lord, he was going to die on that sickbed. He come down to the fact that if God don't do something, then it's going to be over with. Amen. He knew his face and bring to mind the fact that he had no time to waste. And I like what he did. He didn't waste any time. He didn't try to fulfill any fleshly desires. He didn't say he was going out into some great hoorah. He didn't call all the people together and have a big party. He didn't spend all the money he could of the kingdom while he still had control. He got down in business with God. He realized he didn't have no time to waste. He didn't try to fulfill lustly desires, but he turned his face to the wall and he began to pray and weep. I mean, you know, that tears is an important part of being broken inside, that we can pray a fervent prayer unto the Lord. How many did you know that? How many know that a fervent prayer cannot be prayed with a smile on your face? You have to be broken. And he began to pray and to weep. You know what his prayer was? I read it. He said, I beseech you, O Lord, remember how I walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart and have done that which is good in thy sight. This was an honest prayer. God didn't rebuke him in what he was praying. He was praying an honest prayer to God. He had lived right. But good thing, bad things still come to people that live like his. Still, he was going to die. If God didn't change his mind, he was going to die. He said, remember the life I've lived. I walked before you in truth and with a perfect heart. He said, I've done that which was good in thy sight. Amen. Think about that. And the Bible teaches us it was an honest prayer and that it touched the heart of God. We see that and it received the immediate response of the Lord. I thought about if faced with this same message, you and me today, friend of mine, and the Holy Spirit was revealing this unto us, what prayer could you pray based on how you're living? What would be your prayer to God? Now, Hezekiah didn't want to die. None of us want to die till the dying grace comes and God shows us that we're going to a better place. Then it don't matter, but until then, we're going to hold on to life. What prayer could you pray? If the Spirit of God spoke to you right now and said, you're not going to make it back home, you better set your house in order, what kind of prayer could you pray to God? Based on the life that we're living today. Amen. That's important, isn't it? James said in chapter 5 and verse 16, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And that's an eye-opener, ain't it? Effectual. See, that tells me, Wayne, that I can't blame God for unanswered prayer. I can only blame me. I can't blame God for not touching. I can't blame God for not moving. I can't blame God, friend of mine, for not listening. I can only blame me. It's my fault, not God's. Friend of mine, he said, it availeth much. And then he gives unto us Elias or Elijah as an example. And he said, Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are. He said, he ain't no different than us. He's just a man subject to the same passions. But said he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth for a space of 3 years and 6 months. And then he prayed again. And the heaven gave rain and the earth brought forth her fruit. Why did he pray for no rain to start with? Friend of mine, Israel had turned their back on God. They were following after idols. Ahaz and Jezebel had brought idolatry into the land. Friend, they had prophets of the groves and prophets of Baal. And the prophets of God were being killed. Amen. We're living in a time of persecution today, ain't we? We're living in a time where they try to shut up every mouth of everybody that's still preaching, thus saith the Lord. Amen. They don't want your opinion. They want you to live by their opinion. Yeah. Isn't that something today? It's sad today. Amen. That how people are. It's sad how people will jump on a bandwagon even though they hitched up their own mules to pull it for their own self-glory. Sad we're living in a world today when people can't think for themselves. Amen. Isn't it sad? Amen. You know, if you would listen to the news reports and all of the things they were putting out, isn't it amazing how the CNN and all those people tried to convince you how you should vote? It didn't matter if it was truth or lies, they were going to tell it anyway. Because they don't think, hey, what about this bunch of idiots that's up there now that think we don't have the right to vote? That we ought to let them tell us who ought to fill the office. Let me tell you something. If they want my opinion, I'd like to see some of them gone.
Amen.
Right? You know, like we don't have enough sense to know who we want to vote for. God help me, I'm going down the road of senility. I know that. I'm losing a lot of things, but I can still know who I want to vote for. Amen. Amen. Somebody said, what about them didn't have nobody? You know, I kind of think it foolish for me to stand there and take time to put a mark by somebody's name that ain't got nobody running by. Don't y'all? Mark one. Well, I wasn't there and there to mark. Amen. That's something. Thought about it, friend. There's a lot to talk about Hezekiah, Ahab, and Jezebel, but we won't do that tonight. We're trying to get across to you is the fact that there's power in prayer and how it moves the heart of God when it's fervent. America needs to come back to praying fervent prayers. The church needs to come back to praying fervent prayers. Amen. Isn't it amazing how people can live like the life they're living, but they'll tell you they love the Lord? How many of you know the friend of man, the evidence of the tree is the fruit that's on the limb. Yeah. If it's corrupt root, the tree is corrupt. Amen. You can't live an ungodly life, a friend of mine, and have godly fruit. Did you know that? Oh, I better go on. That's another message. But we need a heartfelt prayer according to the will of God. Hezekiah prayed. He believed that he didn't have any time to waste. And he made his petition unto the Lord and knew it was in his hands, God's hands. He prayed, but he left it up to the Lord. He knew it was in God's hands. He didn't want to die, like I said, but it was up to God. And God knew that, and he knew that. And the Bible tells us that before Isaiah had even gone into the middle court, now that's pretty fast, the word of the Lord came unto him and told him to turn again and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, thus saith the Lord, the same Lord that had spoken before was still speaking. The God of David, thy father, I have heard thy prayer, I've seen thy tears. Behold, I will heal thee. And on the third day thou shalt go up into the house of the Lord. And he told him that I will add unto thee 15 years. Amen. 15 years. 15 years is like a drop in the bucket to us now, ain't it? You remember when you were young, how slow time came? Amen. Thought never was going to reach the day that these kids had reached when we'd been in the school. Amen. In the school. Our bus driver, Todd Brown, would carry us down to the little old Cordell's grocery down at where the road intersects below Naomi School, and he'd buy everybody either a Coca-Cola or a candy bar, whichever one they wanted. And I thought, friend of mine, my, I couldn't wait to get that Coca-Cola or candy bar. I just couldn't make up my mind which one I really wanted. Usually ended up with one of them RCs wishing I had a moon pie. Amen. But, you know, that was his way of showing his love for us as children. Amen. Brother Raymond Sutherland, I don't ever remember being on his bus that much, much less being mean. Do y'all ever remember being mean?
No.
He said, I was mean on his buzz. Amen. He loves to tell that when he sees me in church somewhere. Maybe I was, I don't know.
Probably.
Amen. And I didn't sit by you. There's a lot we've forgotten, ain't we? And there's a lot I don't want to remember. Amen. Don't you? Look at these things with Hezekiah. Added 15 years, told him that they was going to deliver the city from the king of Assyria, and that God said, I'm going to defend this for my own sake. I'm going to do it for me, God said. And for his servant David's sake. I believe that God was giving Hezekiah a little space to set his house in order. But, you know, when Isaiah came to him, I don't believe he had long. I really don't. I don't believe Hezekiah, God was giving him much room. And he realized he's running out of time until he made contact with God. And then God gave him 15 years. Amen. You know, I don't know how many of us may be living on borrowed time now. Right? We don't know what we're toting around inside of us just waiting to blow up like a big old bomb and carry us on out of here, do we? Amen. There's people today that has been lived their life, worked every day, and a friend of mine gets sick all of a sudden and going out to meet the Lord. We don't know. That's my place to be ready every day. Every day, right? Amen. Hezekiah, friend of mine, made good use of the time he had by calling upon the Lord. Knowing, friend of mine, that your time is about over is a serious matter. From a deathbed to going up to the house of the Lord in 3 days. And all because Hezekiah knew that he had no time to waste. Look what a difference God made in the heart of a man and the life of a man that come to an understanding that he didn't have any time to waste. And he put what he had to good. Wonder what God would do for you and me if we come to that same understanding in our life. We don't have time to wait. I wonder if we could live our days more to the fullest if we have that kind of understanding in our life. Amen. Hezekiah has lived his life, as I said, in such a manner that he can honestly beseech the Lord to remember his days and consider his faithfulness. I mean, boy, that is quite a testimony that when you can live to where you can call on the Lord, beseech the Lord, beg the Lord, plead with the Lord to remember how I lived. Remember my faithfulness. That's a testimony within itself right there today, right? Amen. Do you not think that God speaks to the heart of the believers through his word still today? It's the word of God that reveals to us how God sees us and gives us instructions. The Holy Spirit brings to light all things that the Lord wants us to know. And he leads us into the prophecies relating to the now times. There's so much out there that God has told us is going to be, but folks ain't focusing on the now times. People are trying to look into tomorrow when the day ain't over with yet. But God will bring us to the word of God, the prophecies of the now time. And he does it so our heart can be warned and we can grasp the certainty that also you and I, we just don't have no time to waste. When you look into the Bible and the prophecies of the word of God and look all around us, read the newspapers, look at the headline, look at how people are living, go down to the parking lot of Walmart. Look at the church. And we just don't have no time to waste, amen, today. I believe God's showing that to us, don't you? Amen. I thought about this. You know, the word of God has always been right on target down through the years. It happened when he said, as he said, and accomplished all that he said, right? Why would we allow ourselves not to think that God's word will continue to be as God said and all that he said will be is coming? We're living in an ever-changing world. Let me tell you something. All these multi-billionaires that gets a ticket on a rocket ship and flies up yonder into one of them big old, you know, all these people think they go up there and build them a society away from the world. I know a bunch I'd like to see, and I'd help buy the ship and send them on.
Amen.
Amen. God knows where they are. God knows where they are, right? You can't hide from God. You can't run away from God. Amen. I seen some little thump something when as I was trying to get to working horses with Jim, said, has the moon got our water? Da 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 da. No, if there's any water on the moon, it ain't ours. God gave it to it. Do you think there's life on the moon? How would I know? I ain't been up there. They brought back moon dirt, and I seen something. Sure enough, Captain, it said the first sign of something growing from moon dirt. Next thing you know, they're going to be going up there sowing turnip greens. That way, there ain't too many people going to want to go because they ain't going to eat that soul food. Do you know what I'm saying? Turnip greens and turn loose a bunch of rabbits. How sad. How sad. Look what God has given us. You know, I believe if we'd made the best out of what God had given us, we wouldn't be so eager to leave it to go somewhere else. Are you right? If we'd have made the best out of what God has given. I think, friend of mine, God's going to do what he said. Hezekiah asked Isaiah, said, what shall be the sign that the Lord will heal me and that I shall go up in the house of the Lord on the third day? I thought about that. Why was he asking, you know? And I felt like, well, maybe he was overwhelmed. Maybe he was overwhelmed by the fact that God answered so quickly. Such a serious matter and a devastating matter that, hey, you're going to die. And now God says you're going to live 15 years. I just thought, well, it would sure overwhelm me. You know what Isaiah told him? That this shall be the sign from the Lord. And then he asked him, said, shall the shadow go forward 10 degrees or back 10 degrees? And he's talking about the shadow of the sun dial, which was not a dial, but was a set of steps, friend of mine, that Ahaz had built. And time was determined as the shadow would come down those steps. They had a post or a column positioned, accurately positioned to where as the sun began to set, it would let the shadow fall 30 minutes at a time. And they could tell time by the shadow on those stairs. Now you tell me that wasn't smart. That was smart. And that's what he was talking about. And notice this. Hezekiah said, it's a light thing for the shadow to go down 10 degrees. In other words, that's a natural process. How's that going to show me anything? It does that every day. You know what he said? He said, let it go backwards. That'll be supernatural. Let it go backwards. Amen. I read about that, and you know, these folks were saying that it was kind of geographically localized miracle, but nonetheless it was spectacular. And what they were saying, that it didn't involve the reversal of the earth's rotation, because if it had reversed the earth's rotation, it would have affected the whole world. And I got to thinking, well, I can't believe that, because the sign was for Hezekiah. It didn't involve nobody else. I don't know how God did it, but I know he did. He did. And Hezekiah knew, friend of mine, that God had heard his prayer and that God was going to answer that prayer according to what God had said. And on the third day that he would go up into the house of the Lord. I believe he was there. I believe on the third day Hezekiah was in the house of God praising God for the fact that he is going to live. I've heard people on a laying on the deathbed that if God, if you'll just heal me, I'll live my life for you, but they didn't. They didn't. I seen a lady that had just black stuff boiling out tubes, and they were going to load her up from one hospital and carry her to another. And she had said, "Lord, if you'll just help me, I'll live my life for you." And friend, before they got her loaded up in the ambulance, all that had done cleared up. But she didn't do what she said to God. And friend of mine, of course she died. She didn't die there in that hospital. God gave her the opportunity to fulfill her promise to the Lord, but she didn't. I thought about, in our hearts, we might not have spoke with our lips, but in our hearts we made an agreement when we got saved with God, we would live our life for God. He'd just save us from the damnations of hell. The question is, have we lived up to that obligation or that promise? Amen. I'm going to close in a moment. But I thought about when there's no more time, when you run out of time, and how the people today need to be awoken to the fact that we're all headed in that direction. How many people do you know that's been on the deathbed? Charles, there's not as many getting off of deathbeds today as they used to be. Used to be, even though somebody was 90 years old, their life was still precious, but it's not much precious in the world today. I'm just telling you the truth. You better live your life for God while you can still make your own decisions, because when you get to where you can't, they'll do what they want to. How many people died in the last few, a couple of years here under the name of COVID, friend of mine, when nobody could get in the hospital to know what needed to be done? They did what they wanted to. Amen!
Amen.
If you ever go to the hospital without carrying somebody in your family that really loves you, you're in trouble. You're in trouble. Did you know that? I better hush. I've already made people mad out there. I don't really care. Amen. Think about this man. This man got off of the deathbed because God heard his prayer. Amen. Have you thought how it would have ended up had Hezekiah not reacted like he did to the news that Isaiah brought him? What if he'd lollygagged around and told himself it's over? What if he'd have just laid there and said, "Well, I'm going to die. I'm going to die." He believed God's word, and he came to terms with the friend of mine, the fact that what it would be, unless he found God's mercy. And he didn't have no time to waste. Sometimes we tell ourselves, it is what it is. It's going to be what God sees fit. Nothing I can do about it. Well, is that entirely true? I've heard people talk about elections and people that's in office. Well, this is God's will. Well, I believe God's will is fulfilling this book. But if you and I were hopeless and helpless in the matters that goes on in life, then why are we commissioned to pray?
Amen.
Why does God say, "Let us come boldly to the throne of grace that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in our time of need"? Why does God say, "Ask, seek, and knock"? With the promise, he that asks and receiveth, he that seeketh findeth, he that knocketh to him, it is open unto him. Why has God given us all of these scriptures and all of these commandments and all of these things if you and I cannot have a voice and bring forth actions in the matters that we're involved in? Amen. It's just too easy to sit back and say, whatever God wants, God wants, yeah, God's will be done, but God give you the power. Look, if God was going to let this man die, but God gave him the power through prayer to give him 15 years, what could God do for you and me if we just get where God wants us to be here tonight?
Amen.
Amen. I get tired of hearing people. They're just too lazy to live their life like God wants you to live. Well, it's going to be what it's going to be. Yeah, if you keep sitting on your hind end and doing nothing. Right? When good people do nothing, evil runs rampant. And that's where we're at today. There was a time people wasn't ashamed to be called a Christian, but it ain't that way anymore. Right? It just ain't that way anymore. Friend of mine, listen, I'll hurry. Do we not have the Word of God as witness to the miraculous things that He accomplished through prayer? Prayer. And there are too many to remember, but we can read them, and they're written for our hearts to give us assurance and hope. How wrong is it, do you think, to sit around and do nothing? Nothing. We don't call the sick. We don't visit the sick. We don't go out and testify. I know some of you do, but I'm talking about the whole church realm as a world. Everybody thinks if you build a great big old building of $1 million buildings and you got an orchestra playing and you got YouTube and stuff that's going all over the world and you're writing books and that people are just going to flood your church, they're flooding it for the wrong reason. Or the church needs a witness, right? The church needs to be a beacon. There was a time the church was a beacon. There was a time that a friend of mine, the community respected the church and honored the church's advice when it comes to changes and being made in the community. There was a time there would not have been no beer joint and lottery place up this end and one down there. I'll guarantee you, there was a time that the church would have shut the doors on them places. Amen. Look where we're at today. Is it wrong? How wrong? Oh, we know it's wrong, but how wrong in what degree is it for us to sit around and do nothing when we can see all the great needs all around us? You know, if we were not intended to take part in this warfare, then why does God say put on the whole armor? If we wasn't intended to have a fight and be a part of this spiritual battle, then why did God tell us to prepare for it? Right? Why, friend of mine, did he tell Timothy in 2 Timothy 2 and 3, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ? A good soldier, friend of mine, faces the task at hand. A good soldier gives his best. A good soldier stays in the fight until victory comes. We're instructed to be good soldiers. But we can't fight the fight, my friend, when we've got our back turned.
Amen.
Can we? Amen. You know, it's going to be a sad day when judgment comes and all the souls that we could have won, that we see, and we didn't try. Amen. Think about all the people that's gone through these buildings that's got the name of God out there on their sign that never preaches about sin, that never tries to warn nobody. It ain't popular, Wayne. It ain't popular. Our little church, we've got the greatest thing in the world to offer. That's Jesus Christ and Him crucified, but the world ain't looking for that. They're looking for clubs and groups and all this stuff. Amen. One guy I invited to church wanted to know what we had for the kids. I said, we got Jesus Christ and Him crucified and we preached the Word of God. I said, all the extra activity in them kids' life is up to you as their parent. Woo! Did that go over like a lead balloon? But how true it is, right? But we're running out of time. Get us a song. I'm going to have to close. But I want you to think about some of those things. You know, we're being confronted with the perilous times that are witness to the fact that the days we're living in are the last days. These perilous times tell us that this is the last days. Why? Because Paul said in Timothy that in the last days there should be perilous times. There's 19 sins listed there. I believe it's chapter 3. 19 sins, and every one of them is evident right in our own back door. We're seeing this. Things has changed. And we're still so many unaware that we have no time to waste. With every passing minute and hour and day, you know what? We are closer to the Lord's coming. We're one day closer to Jesus than we was yesterday. Amen. We're just one day closer. We don't know when he's coming. He might come before we get home. It would be all right. You know, I told me and Joanne was talking. She said, I don't know about you, but I wish the Lord would come. I said, yeah, but I sure would feel better knowing that all that the grandkids and all were prepared to meet the Lord. And, you know, she said, yeah, me too. But said, it's going to happen, ain't it? Whether or not they're ready. It is going to happen. We're running out of time. Running out of time. All of our lives we've heard about the coming of the Lord. And we thank, friend of mine, I'm 67 years old, and I think that's been a long time, but that ain't nothing with the Lord. Kathy, the Lord says a day is as 1,000 years with the Lord, and 1,000 years as a day. So what's my little 67 years, friend of mine, to God? See, the long-suffering of God didn't take into account of how old or young I am. It's just when God sees fit for this thing to come to a head. According to God, we're about to enter the third day, right?
Yep. Amen.
The third day. I'm talking about since Jesus left this world. We're coming into the third day. A lot of things happen in the Bible on the third day. I'm not saying he's coming. I'm just saying what's to keep him from coming.
Amen.
Huh? Amen. It's imminent. The rapture is imminent. That means there's no signs. We don't. He's just going to come. He's just going to come. Amen. As I said Sunday, if your heart beats 70 times a minute, that's 85 one-hundredths of a second that your heart is beating, and the Lord is coming in the moment of twinkling of an eye. That's 11 one-hundredths of a second. So before your heart could beat, the Lord could have already come, raptured the church, and it'd all be over with. How is anyone going to get saved doing that? It's something to think about, ain't it? If there was a time we need to agonize with God over our loved ones, it's now. It's now. I know there's a lot of people just don't want to believe. And they're going to be the one that cry out the loudest when it comes time to die. I believe tonight, folks, that if we could walk the halls of these hospitals, if it wasn't for the fact that they had these people completely numbed and dead, deadened through the drugs, I believe there'd be some horrible cries on the halls of the hospital of people that are crying out because of what they see, the place they're going, and they're not prepared to meet God. I believe there'd be some horrible cries. I told y'all before, some of you don't know, my grandmother and grandfather, I used to go up there in the evening and sit and listen to them talking. And they talk about things, and they talk about, they call them by name. At least they call the name of this one they would sit. You know, people used to go sit with the sick. You know, they didn't have a rest home that they put. They sit with the sick, and they call this one's name, and they were talking about it, and how they was trying to hold them into bed, and they were hollering and screaming to pull them up, to pull them up, to pull them up, to get their feet out of the fire. Folks, this is real. This wasn't no Hollywood movie they were talking about. This was real. They lived this. They saw it. They heard it. They were dying, unprepared to meet God. We don't have no time to waste. Hell is enlarging herself without measure. Every day, while we're here right now, somebody's going to die and go to hell. I hope to God it's not someone that I missed an opportunity to witness to. I don't need any more blood on my hands. I don't want any more blood on my hands. Do you? We don't have any time to waste. If you'll bow your head, there's never been a time when the fields are more whiter for harvest than they are now. And sadly, there's never been a time when the laborers was any less than they are now. The call is going out for God's service, and we must realize that we don't have no time to waste. Here I am, Lord, right? How long has it been since you prayed a prayer to God? Here I am, God, use me. Use me, Lord. Amen. You here in the church tonight, you have a decision to make. You out there in the unseen audience, you have a decision to make. You need to come to terms with the fact that you're running out of time. Could you pray a prayer as Hezekiah prayed? Are you living that close to the Lord? Could you get God's attention that quickly? Something to think about. While Joseph plays, you're here tonight. How many people do you know that could have been the same one that Grandpa and Granny was trying to hold in the bed? How many people do you know that's heading in that same direction tonight? They never professed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I don't know if you understand it or not, but hell's a real place. The fires of hell is real, the damnations is sure. The rich man still crying out for a drop of water. If his five brothers didn't get right, they're there crying out beside him. Although it won't matter who's in there with you, because the agony of that soul that's in hell will be consumed. That'll consume them. It won't matter who else is there. We're running out of time, folks. There was a time we need to be on praying terms with God. It's right now. Pray that God would let them tell you, because they are. If you don't know they are, then pray that God would let them be. Your family. I pray for my family every night that they'll get saved, although I know I've got some that don't want to hear it, don't want to know. But my obligation to God is to pray for those that are lost and on their way to hell. You got a prayer you want to pray? Come. Come on, Mike. Wait, we still got time. God may be giving you the last time to pray your last prayer. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just telling you reality. That's what it was going to be for Hezekiah. But not God's grace being shown. If this was your last prayer, what would you pray? Tonight, well, I know we've been slow, Bon, a little on the droopy side. But what I'm trying to get the point out, when we're running out of time, so many hearts are unaffected by that truth. So many live in self-denial that it could ever happen to them, but yet, God, it's all coming. One day our heart will beat for its last time. Our last breath here will be our first breath somewhere. Somewhere. According to how we've lived. Whether or not we've received His Lord and Savior. God, we got so many loved ones tonight that are just living so carelessly. Hungered after all that the world has got to give. Unaware of the fact that all these things are going to melt with a fervent heat. It's all going to burn up. What will they have then? We got so many of God across this land today that have turned their back on you. Turned their back on your church. Oh, they look for your blessings, but you just don't want to live the life that it takes to receive. God, I ask you tonight that your spirit would move across our land. Move in our homes. That we might stand upon the truth. That we might be a trumpet carrying forth your word.
Lord, if there's anything in my heart tonight that has hindered anybody, forgive me. Lord, there's going to be prayers I'm going to need to pray tonight. God, there's going to be things I need to talk to you about before I lay my head on the pillar there always is. God, I beseech you tonight that if there's anything that would hinder your response, God, that you would forgive me now. Lord, I seek your mercy, I seek your grace now. And I just thank you for loving me, for plucking me out of the flames of hell, for giving me everlasting life. The greatest gift I've ever had, you gave yourself to me. I do love you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Up in people's minds to try to bring confusion. But God is not the author of confusion. That's the devil. God stands on what he says. He means what he says and says what he does what he says. He's God. He's unchanging. I do thank you for listening to me tonight. I hope you got something out of that message. I know I wasn't jumping no pews and wasn't hollering and stomping my feet. And amen. And I didn't spit on nobody. So, but I hope you got something out of the message tonight. When there is no time to waste, and I believe we're facing that right now. Don't y'all? Yeah. All right, we appreciate our comments. We appreciate our Facebook crowd and appreciate our church.
Wanda had put a prayer request on there to remember her nephew. He's the one that fell 80 to 100 feet off the mountain. They've got him on suicide watch and things that's going on. So just remember him, she said.
Amen.
And we got a rest home service tomorrow evening, so remember that.
Amen. All right, let's pray for these requests and any request that's been sent in and all of your spoken and unspoken requests. How many of y'all got a family that you know has never made a testimony of having Jesus in their heart?
Amen.
Amen. We're running out of time. Let's pray for them. Let's pray the Lord a touch. And you say, well, my prayer won't save them. No, it won't. But I believe God will answer your prayer and deal with their hearts. They gotta say yes or no, but we can pray God's conviction down on them, can't we?
Amen.
And I'm not talking about praying a harmful prayer. I'm talking about praying a prayer of conviction through love, that we love the fact that we love their soul, that God would deal with their soul. That's what I want. I want God to deal with their soul. Amen. He can take a stick and beat him on the outside, but it'll take repentance to get him in on the inside, right?
Amen.
All right. Good night, Facebook. May the Lord bless you.